Hi, my name is Kent. I'm the creative specialist on the Google Web Designer team, and I'd like to show what's new in video editing with Google Web Designer. One of the biggest changes is responsive video. So just like a responsive banner ad, now you can create video files in multiple sizes. This is a pretty big innovation and departure from traditional video editing software because you can create video ads in all sizes, tall, square, and wide, all from the same assets in a single file. When starting a new file, you'll see this option for multi-size layout. Here's a file I've already started, and the workflow is exactly like a responsive banner ad with controls for the base document and size and range rules. Check the links in the description below for tutorials on building responsive documents. Another big change is being able to create animated GIFs. You can start from a new file, selecting animated GIF, and notice again multi-size layouts are supported. Or you can export an animated GIF from any existing video file. Here's one I've started. It's a video file with no video content, just motion graphics, and it's responsive and dynamic. If I want to make an animated GIF from just this flipping logo by itself, I'd set the preview range to this part only, and now when I publish this video file, here's where I choose animated GIF, and select the responsive sizes I want, and dynamic variants, frame rate, resolution, that preview range we set. Colors and dither will help reduce file size, and the number of times to loop your animation, or forever. Then OK, and this will publish all files. But it goes pretty quick, and now I can preview. Here's where you choose which files to preview, and the responsive sizes, and the dynamic variants. Working with audio files is easier with volume controls that'll be familiar to many users. First, I'll bring in an audio file. Note my cursor movement is being tracked in the timeline up here, so if I wanted to import an asset at an exact time, I'd click an empty space in the timeline and File, Import Assets, or drag from my library to insert it at the current time. And the same for video files, just not images, which always import to frame one. For those seeing this for the first time, any audio track will have this hairline right in the middle representing the volume. You drag it up or down to change the volume, and all the way down is the same as muting the clip. Hit playback to check the levels, and in this case, it's essentially the same as the track volume over here because I only have one clip. I use the razor tool from the timeline toolbar to cut out a shorter section of audio, and then the timeline selection tool to delete the rest. Then I can option drag to duplicate this clip, and with one volume higher than the other, now it's different from the track volume, which affects every clip in the track and sort of sets a baseline for the envelope volume in these clips. Control click the volume line to add nodes, which are like keyframes to author volume changes. Now I can change the volume over different sections of my clip. Control click the starting node of each transition to choose one of these presets, like smooth. A common use case is to ease in and out of an audio clip, and a shortcut is to use these little plus icons. Another common use case is to drop the volume over a short section to cut out a word or phrase in a voiceover track. I can zoom into the track with the timeline control, and then expand the track height to see more detail in the waveform. And here's where you could literally see the word you're looking for if you played this a couple times. Then add those nodes again. And you get the idea. Then when I'm done, I can make the track smaller again, double-click to make it tiny, and double-click again to restore the previous height. Same for video tracks, which don't get quite as short since space is reserved for keyframes. And lastly, under the Timeline Layer Settings menu is Minimize All Layers, handy for larger complex docs. Those are about the biggest new features, but there's still more, so I'll just run through a few quickly, and most of this applies to both HTML and video file types. First up is visibility ranges. So for example, if I create a title or headline and only want it shown for a short period of time, I can drag the starting marker out and right-click to set the end marker. And now my element is shown only in this range. And I can marquee select to move it around. This is an alternative to setting opacity keyframes and helps timeline readability by being able to spot these ranges at a glance. in longer files, as you add more and more elements, it's really nice to not have them appear until needed. Also with text, we can control the letter spacing and line height. Since we're on text, here's an awesome new feature, text effects, which if you don't see, you can turn on in the window menu. Then I can choose an effect, apply it, and scrub the playhead to see the results. And there's a lot of settings here that I'll show in detail in another video. Again, check the description. Here's a common effect with keyframes. I'll use scale to make this text zoom into position. Control-click to create a keyframe and set the scale. Then on the first keyframe, make the scale large. But it can be a little hard to envision the final effect when you're seeing the contents outside of the stage. So click this stage mask icon, and now you get a clear picture of the final output. Another big change is doc type conversion support, so now it's easy to work between different file types. For example, here's an HTML5 banner ad, and if I want to add this logo animation to my video file, then I can just copy the entire layer, Command-C, and paste into my video file with keyboard Command-V. I can also do a wholesale conversion of an entire H5 document into a video file preserving all my keyframes. For example, here's a responsive template for a banner ad in 21 sizes. I'll choose File, Convert Document Type, Video, and here's where you'd select the responsive size to convert, and the output size, which I'll leave as is. And here's compatibility notes, in this case about events which don't apply to video. And when I convert, the new video file opens in a tab, and I can see all my animation and layering structure is preserved and is still editable. Dynamic files will convert sample data to dynamic video variants. When I publish a video, I'll see controls for compression quality, including different profiles and bit rates, but I usually don't change these. And one last tip, working with clips, you can scrub the playhead to find the exact time or animation you want, like just when this big text starts appearing, and then you can drag an audio or video clip and snap to that frame. In general, when moving clips around, they snap together to avoid gaps in your sequences. That's it for this video, but there's even more new features I didn't have time to cover. Check for more videos in the comments below. Thanks for watching!